Well, it has a number of terms actually that are being used. One of them is, as you notice, is treatment fidelity, but there are other sort of synonyms or more or less equivalent terms such as procedural integrity or treatment integrity or procedural reliability. So there's like four or five different terms that are being used. And what it means though, the concept related to treatment is that the that you measure that the intervention is implemented as you had planned. So you have a treatment protocol and you want to make sure that the treatment is carried out as you had intended. Why is it important? It's important because if you don't know how the treatment was implemented, it becomes very difficult to know what the change, what the causal factor in the change was. So you sort of reach a certain outcome, but you cannot really attribute it to something concrete because you don't know how well the treatment was implemented. So it affects internal validity, it affects external validity. So it's a really an important aspect of treatment research. You have to think about sort of how does the treatment break down into steps, and you want those steps to be reflective of what the active ingredient of the intervention is. So sometimes you see in the literature there are steps laid out and they're measured, everything, you know, good reliability, good treatment integrity, but the steps may not be necessarily reflective of what the key construct is. So it's important that those steps are related to what your theory of change is. So you have a certain theory and you want to make sure that those steps are reflective of it. So that's one aspect. The other challenge is that you want you have to think about what method are you going to use to evaluate treatment fidelity. So you can use self-monitoring. So that is when the experimenter, him or herself, basically does check marks or takes notes. So that's one method. The second method is you have a second observer, and the second observer basically takes notes or records how well the experimenter does. That's the second method. And the third method is where you have the experimenter take notes and the second observer, and then you compare and you derive what is called inter-observer agreement on treatment fidelity. So the second and the third step are not mutually exclusive. You can do both. So that's a big thing to think about in terms of measuring treatment fidelity. You want also another challenge is how many sessions do you need? You know, do you need 100%, or is it okay to have maybe 20 to 30%? And there are no clear-cut rules about this, but in general, journal editors and reviewers like to see above sort of 20% at least of the observations. But in the beginning, when I started doing this kind of work, I was under the illusion that that I can design this at the desk and then the experimenter will implement it as I had planned. When you design an intervention, you know, basically at your desk, okay, it all looks very, you know, deliberate and concrete and logical, and then you actually ask somebody to implement, and there are steps missing, unforeseen circumstances happening, and the whole thing will fall apart, and you have to start from scratch, and then you have to. It's kind of an iterative process to develop a good treatment fidelity protocol. I have learned the hard way that you always have to pilot. So for multiple reasons, pilot studies are really important, but related to treatment fidelity, it is essential, because you don't know is this actually doable. You prepare a data collection sheet and the observer says this is too cumbersome, I couldn't keep up, you know, especially if it's done live. If you have recorded, that's a, you know, that you might want to think about, do I do live or do I do video recording? These have pros and cons too. The live observation requires somebody to be there right there. And video recording has added flexibility. Can be watched at any time. It can be replayed. So you have to think about that too. What I've observed in the real, you know, real implementation is sometimes the experimenter feels very conscious about being watched. They feel they might feel anxious. You know, am I doing the right thing? And so the researcher has to be careful about how to approach this. You know, this is not about Big Brother is watching you. it's more about we'd like for you as the experimenter to do the best job possible to deliver the intervention. So we'd like to work with you and give you feedback as you proceed doing this, and we can actually help you do better if needed. And so that, you know, you kind of phrase it like, we are in this together, we're trying to deliver the best intervention we can, and let's make it happen, so that the kind of the anxiety goes away. And you know, there's sort of a progression of research, and there are many people who have written about this in our field. Initially, you want to have really good control and really good treatment integrity, and so that's the primary objective. You want to have it as perfect as possible. But then, as you go into real practice, there are all kinds of constraints imposed on implementing an intervention that, you know, it's different from a study, as you know. And so there it becomes sometimes important to do a study with less integrity. You know, sort of the treatment fidelity becomes the independent variable that you're manipulating. Can the same treatment outcomes be attained by having less perfect implementation? Because assuming that the clinician is not a robot and has to be responsive to what happens with the clients, you want them to be more flexible. So, but can you attain still the same outcomes? So that's, you know, so it's, so there's, yeah, we should follow this progression and measure, use, study multiple, do multiple studies, and then hopefully get to the point where we can reach outcomes in real life settings with real life expectations of what is reasonable in terms of fidelity. Yeah.